Uncle Dan.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Do you remember when we were youngsters?
I remember when Rock was young.
Back,
me and Susie
had so much fun.
Oh, it was a
blast. Who do you think Susie was?
Who do you remember? Do I think?
Susie was actually a guy named Ron.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, back when we were youth, there used to be a thing on the TV that would come on at 10 o'clock at night that would say, "It's 10 o'clock. Do you know where your children are?" Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do remember that.
Yeah.
That's creepy. I don't know why I was thinking about that. Awesome.
Yeah.
Well,
I was just thinking about that.
Yeah, and then it's a good thing you thought about that because I want to talk about a parent who did not know where his daughter was for a good 9 months.
Oh,
sure.
That's going to be a lot of fun. I can feel that we're about to have a lot of fun.
Yeah, this is a pretty fun
like,
one.
Like me and Susie.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, yeah. We're sometimes pretty hard on religion on this podcast, and it's pretty much our stated position that religion, at the very best, tarnishes anything good, and at worst is a needlessly destructive force that causes massive damage to everything it touches.
Well, I need to see more proof of that.
Exactly. Lest anybody listening to our voices think that we are being too hard on religion, that it's a good environment to raise children, that, yeah, there's some bad stuff, but it's better than no belief system. Well, hypothetical listener, today's segment is for you. We're going to talk about a true story, one that is unfolding, actually, as we speak, that pretty much demonstrates how religion stains everything and how much better the world would be without it. Today we're going to talk about Elizabeth Smart and her father, Ed. We're going to tread really lightly here because all the people we're going to talk about are still alive. And some of them are victims of incredible trauma, the likes of which we cannot imagine.
This is a true horrible family. Tragedy.
Gentlemen, these are Mormons. They're all victims of trauma.
That's right.
That's true. That's not even a joke.
No,
it's true.
Yeah.
And were it not for the fact that the saga has reemerged in a wholly predictable but unexpected way, it would be just another tragic and sad chapter from Utah/Mormon history, however.
Yeah.
Just a couple of days ago.
Just another portrait John McNaughton forgot to paint.
That's right. just a couple of days ago, Elizabeth's father, Ed, 64 years old, stunned the world with the admission that he is indeed a gay man.
Stunned literally zero people.
Right.
So I tried to fake a gasp there, and I couldn't even do it.
Right. The fact that he's a gay man is not much of a surprise to those of us who followed this saga back in 2002. While his daughter was kidnapped, Ed would make nearly daily appearances to the press in his driveway. How can I put this correctly? Well, he really seemed gay, right?
Yeah.
So, basically,
it was like Corky Sinclair
giving
press conferences about a kidnapping.
Yeah,
and then mentioning
seriously.
That he buys all of his wife's clothes.
That's right. Yeah, so it's not a surprise to find out that our suspicions were correct. What was surprising is that he himself admitted it. He was not caught in flagrante in some airport restroom or some blackmail scheme. Ed made the considered decision to publicly come out, in spite of how the story would be received by his friends, family, and the world at large. Most of us ex-Mormons know older men and women who are married in the church with children, who are obviously gay but will never come out and will die, therefore repressed and pretty miserable.
Yeah.
Such is the shame and ostracization that come with admitting that you are who you are to those who are supposed to love you unconditionally. So, before we dive into the story of Ed, we need to go back and talk about his daughter, Elizabeth, which is why we know Ed and the Smart family.
Yeah, we really shouldn't know anything about these people.
Right.
This is just a boring family.
Yep.
Until...
Yeah. Back in 2002, when a 14-year-old Elizabeth was kidnapped right out of her bedroom and disappeared into the foothills around Salt Lake City.
In a very high-end neighborhood.
Very high-end neighborhood, correct. And this is a pretty touchy subject, so most of the source material I'm using is from Elizabeth Smart herself in the form of her book, My Story, pardon me, and the surprisingly good A&E movie, I Am Elizabeth Smart, which actually starred Skeet Ulrich as Mitchell, who we'll talk about, and Deidre Lovejoy from The Wire as Barzee, and an incredible actress named Alana Bowden as Elizabeth Smart.
Wait, Skeet Ulrich played the Manuel?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. And the whole thing is narrated by Elizabeth Smart herself, so we'll talk a little bit about it. I'm going to try and avoid any inappropriate speculation, but there are some gaps that can only be filled with speculation, so we'll just tread as lightly as we feel we need to.
Okay. Yeah.
So the kidnapping made national news. It didn't hurt that she was white, but also the very idea that a child could be the victim of a kidnapping in their own room next to her sleeping sister while her parents are downstairs watching TV is the stuff of nightmares. So I'm just going to jump ahead real quick and tell everybody that 9 months later, she was found alive and at least physically fairly healthy.
Yeah, that was unfucking believable.
I almost drove off the road when I heard it.
I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
I had CNN on, just ran. I was cleaning the house and I had CNN on the TV. And I've never seen this happen on CNN before or since. Like in the oldie timey news times, a hand came from off screen with a piece of paper and handed it to Wolf Blitzer.
Wow.
Who read Elizabeth Smart has been found alive and well in Salt Lake City. I was like, what?
So, I mean, so we were all shocked because we all knew for a fact that that girl was dead. Like, of course.
Nationally, less than 2% of long-term kidnapping victims are ever found alive.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
All right, so before we talk about Elizabeth, we need to go back a little bit further and talk about one Brian David Mitchell, a.k.a. Emmanuel, Elizabeth's kidnapper, captor, and rapist. Mitchell was born in Salt Lake in 1953 to a Mormon household with an abusive and very strange father. His life was marked by failed marriages, way too many children, accusations of physical and sexual abuse by some of his wives and children, and drug and alcohol abuse. He at one point even kidnapped two of his kids for a short period when he lost custody. So let's just say he had a type and a pattern. Here's a fun tidbit. One of his stepchildren from the second marriage told her mother that Mitchell had sexually abused her for 4 years. Instead of alerting authorities, she told her LDS leadership, who advised her to forget about it. So, could have been stopped.
Yeah.
So, upon divorcing his second wife, he immediately married Wanda Barzee, who was divorced herself with 6 children.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, right? And just to be clear, Barzee is not a victim in this story. In fact, Smart would go on to say that she was even crueler and more evil than Mitchell. So, the couple threw themselves into the Mormon church. Mitchell, as Uncle Mark brought this up one time in the past episode, Mitchell was actually played Satan in the endowment ceremony in the Salt Lake Temple, which is
I had forgotten that. Oh my God!
And for just a tiny bit of background on that, it's kind of like a little bit of a passion play you do as a kind of ritual in the Mormon Church. There's an actor who plays God and Jesus and Satan, and
But it's kind of like a high honor to be allowed to do this.
It's a bit of a big deal. And he was so, apparently, his portrayal was so unnerving, he was fired.
apparently a general authority saw it and was like, get that guy out of here.
Right?
Yeah, when you're playing Satan and everybody's like, that's too crazy, that's too creepy, maybe somebody watch that guy a little extra close.
Apparently he would like writhe on the floor like a snake. Yeah, man.
Yeah, you went too far.
You went a little too far.
Mormons, that's like 22 steps.
Did you guys ever give him money?
Yeah. Yeah, we'll talk about that. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And it's really a missed opportunity in the Mormon church that there's not an award show for the actors that play in the temple ceremony. The Anti-Nephi Lehi Awards or something like that.
The Mormies.
The Mormies. It's a little Leona statue. Yeah. Leonis. So by the 1990s, Mitchell had changed his name to Emmanuel and separated from the Mormon church. He grew out his beard and claimed that he was a prophet. Barzee renamed herself, let me get this wrong, Hephzibah, which apparently means God adorneth. And the two began wearing long white robes. And this is, as Uncle Mark said, this is where we come into the story. Because everyone in Salt Lake City at that time knew these two.
Yeah, everybody saw these people. They were everywhere.
And they were all over downtown. They stood out like crazy. They're very, very strange. And I gave him money on one occasion.
I never gave him money. But, I mean, they looked like, You just thought they were Hare Krishnas or something.
Something like that.
He looked like an Old Testament prophet, and that the only reason I gave him money was because he put a little showbiz into it.
Right.
I'm like, okay, you got a costume. That's good. Here's a quarter.
And what's so crazy about what's about to happen is that the two most widely recognizable faces in all of Utah were together in this period of time, and no one would recognize them. It's very strange.
Yeah, super weird.
Now, Ed, now being a confirmed closeted homosexual, had a habit of hiring homeless men to do odd jobs around their quite nice house. So yes. I'm not going to speculate whether his repressed sexual impulses inform that habit or not, but in any case, one of these homeless men he hired was one Brian David Mitchell. Mitchell worked on the roof of their house for a single day, but it was enough to get eyes on young Elizabeth and get the lay of the land. He apparently spoke to Elizabeth and her younger sister for at least a moment or two, a fact that will come into play a little bit later on. So, early on June 5th, 2002, Mitchell cut through the screen of Elizabeth's bedroom window and entered the room. Elizabeth was asleep next to her little sister. And Mitchell woke her up by holding a gun to, pardon me, a knife to her neck and a hand over her mouth. He told her not to scream or he would kill her and her family. Her sister did wake up during this, but was so terrified that she didn't get out of bed. She was paralyzed by fear for a couple hours after the fact. The very, very critical and crucial hours.
Yeah.
So Mitchell took Elizabeth into the foothills around Salt Lake, where he had made camp with Barzee. They immediately forced her to put on a robe, and Mitchell performed some kind of marriage ceremony, at which point he raped her. This may have happened even before her parents knew she was missing. In the film, this rape is depicted graphically and unflinchingly, and then it cuts immediately to Elizabeth herself looking directly into the camera. It's intense.
Whoa.
And yeah. this was an A&E. This wasn't like, right?
A&E,
this was
yeah.
on basic cable. That's really interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. Mitchell would go on to rape her every single day of her 9-month captivity, sometimes multiple times. The fact that she survived and is an outspoken and honest advocate for victims' rights about this. She's a truly remarkable person, honestly.
Yeah.
So when news broke the next day, search parties were formed with several thousand volunteers combing the area. I never did one of the search parties, but I know a ton of people who did. Did either of you guys go join in
did
the
I?
Search?
No.
Elizabeth says she heard the search parties calling her name on several occasions. She was so close. The reason she did not cry out or try to escape later in her captivity when they cut off her chain was by her admission, partly out of fear for her life and partly because of the guilt of having been raped. She had been told by teachers in the Mormon church that once a woman had given up her virginity, she was like a chewed up piece of gum that nobody would want anymore.
Yeah.
That was the specific language. The more Mitchell raped her, the more valueless she felt, and the more she was convinced she would have no place in her former life. Mitchell also forced her to drink and take drugs, which also played into her feelings of guilt and alienation.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Yeah, kind of amazing. She was very clearly part of a... the cult that we were all raised in taught her that...
Yeah.
Until that she had value until she was in any way besmirched, and then fuck it.
Yeah, you've used it up.
Yeah, and by the way, I heard an interview with Elizabeth Smart where, yes, she got that shit in church like all of us did, but she specifically said she got it from a teacher in her public school.
Yeah.
Jesus.
That a teacher at Salt Lake City's East High School, and I don't know who that teacher was, fucking said that to her in public school.
Jesus.
Well, but let's be clear that teacher was likely also Mormon.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah, I mean, almost 100% likely, yes, exactly. Yeah.
So the full details of her captivity are a little long to cover here, but there are some incredible moments that are worth mentioning. On a couple of occasions, she came so close to being exposed and saved that it's heartbreaking. Mm. Mitchell forced her to wear a veil and at one point took her and Barzee to the Salt Lake Public Library to research routes to California. Someone alarmed by the sight of this kook with two veiled women called the police, and an officer actually spoke to them. Mitchell claimed that his religion forbade his women from removing their veils or speaking in public, and because this is Utah... And because of the fact that a wackadoo polygamous cults are a dime a dozen, and due to the fact that buried in the DNA of all men in Utah is the notion that women are actually property, the cop let them go.
Yep.
So another crazy moment that blew everyone away once it was exposed was their appearance at a local party house called China Blue. This is like a rundown house near downtown Salt Lake City that hosted drug-fueled ragers. I've been to a party there.
Oh, yeah.
Once upon a time. Mitchell and Barzee took Elizabeth to a party there where Elizabeth was even photographed. The person taking the photo was only gawking at freaks, and it wasn't until after she was found that it came out.
Wow.
Wasn't it also a Halloween party?
Might have been.
I think that was part of it, is that, you know, everybody was in costume, I think, and so nobody thought too much of it.
China Blue is no place for any 14-year-old girl. For a 14-year-old Mormon girl, it must have been as terrifying as the alternative, right?
Yeah.
In Mormonism, a person who has a glass of port at Christmas is exactly equal to Walter White.
Yeah, it's exactly. Basically that. Yeah.
Yeah, and so if she had just simply lifted her veil and screamed out, she would have been rescued. But yes. to her adolescent Mormon brain, the people smoking weed were just as evil as the man raping her. So
right.
She didn't cry out, and no one recognized
her. That's a good point. Like, she would have. Somebody there would have. They would have done something, for sure.
Yeah.
Her face was so in the news.
If she had said the words, "I am Elizabeth Smart," quietly to herself,
the
guy she was with would have been tackled instantly.
Right.
Yeah.
So
and her picture was on every telephone pole and storefront in town, right?
It
was
national news.
Those posters were still up everywhere.
That's right.
Yeah.
After 3 months, Mitchell stopped chaining Elizabeth up at all. Such were the physical restraints, or the psychological restraints that he placed under on her. Yeah. He then dragged them to the California desert outside of San Diego, where Elizabeth and Barzee flirted with starvation while Mitchell sojourned into town to steal booze and keep himself nearly perpetually drunk. At one point, Mitchell broke into a church, got drunk on the sacramental wine, and got himself arrested. God, and in his week-long absence, Elizabeth and Barzee came awfully damn close to starving.
Like, wow.
Seriously close. So during the captivity, Ed and the family managed to keep Elizabeth in the news, which they thought correctly was the only hope they had of finding her. Yeah. Mostly they did this by Ed's aforementioned press conferences in his driveway. Finally, her sister managed to remember that the kidnapper's voice was that of a homeless guy that worked on their roof. The police were skeptical, but the family had a sketch done, and once it was publicized in the press, Mitchell's family recognized him. So now the police knew who the kidnapper was.
Holy cow.
Yeah, right? When it was a very strange thing. It was like 6 months later, the little sister's like, wait a minute, I remember who it was.
That's so weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, memory's really fucking strange.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
So,
well, and that's one of those things where it's like, I would be, if I'm a cop in that situation, and I'm going off of like, 6 months after, and it's a little girl's memory.
Yeah, you're like,
so
yeah, whatever.
I'd be like, I mean,
yeah,
draw a picture if you want to. Let's see what we can do. But like, I'm not holding out any hope on
exactly.
that.
Exactly.
Right.
So in the ninth month of her captivity, Mitchell and Barzee decided to head back to Utah, where on March 12th, 2003, police finally recognized them, and this part of her ordeal ended.
Yeah.
Wow. So Mitchell initially tried to plead insanity due to his delusion that he was a prophet of God. I just love how religion helps out in this
that
scenario.
That seems legit, actually, right. At this point. Like, I would almost buy that.
And that decision about his competency delayed the sentencing until 2010. So it was almost 8 years later before he was actually tried.
Wow.
Was it that long? Yeah, it was that long.
That's ridiculous.
He was finally convicted of kidnapping and transporting a minor across state lines with intent to engage in sexual activity, which is now referred to as the full Epstein.
Shit.
He is serving a life sentence in Tucson, Arizona. Barzee pled guilty and was sentenced to 15 years in federal prison.
Why is he in Arizona?
I'm not exactly sure why it ended up in Arizona. It was because they crossed state lines. And it might just be that's the penitentiary that he ended up
well,
in.
He's in federal pen, right?
Yeah,
that's right.
Once he crossed the state lines, it became a federal thing.
Yeah, and it wasn't crime, the state of Utah. The state of Utah never figured out how to prosecute him.
Well, kidnapping is a federal crime anyway, right?
Right.
I don't know.
Barzee served her time.
Don't take legal advice from a podcast.
Yeah, exactly. Barzee actually was released from prison in September of 2018, a decision that Elizabeth Smart obviously protested.
It's good that she's out on the street. She's
rehabilitated. Smart would go on to be a child safety activist. She founded the Elizabeth Smart Foundation. She got married. She had two kids. It's pretty remarkable that she managed to make the recovery that she's made, honestly.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, and then this brings us to last week, when Ed posted a letter on Facebook acknowledging the fact that he is, and always has been, a gay man. This letter is pretty sad and painful to read, mostly because of the shocking reality of anti-gay sentiment in the Mormon Church today.
Yeah.
Here's a couple quotes from that letter. "This is one of the hardest letters I have ever written. Hard because I am finally acknowledging a part of me that I have struggled with most of my life and never wanted to accept, but I must be true and honest with myself. It is in this same spirit that I wish to share the news that I have recently acknowledged to myself and my family that I am a gay man. The decision to be honest and truthful about my orientation comes with its own set of challenges, but at the same time, it's a huge relief. I have mostly watched in silence for years as many LGBTQ individuals, both in and out of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, have been victims of ridicule, shunning, rejection, and outright humiliation. I didn't want to face the feelings I fought so hard to suppress, and didn't want to reach out to tell those being ostracized that I too am numbered among them, but I cannot do that any longer. Some will say that I have wasted my years here by not coming out sooner. Others have said you're giving up so much for so little, and you know how the Lord feels about gays. They have concluded that I've chosen to waste my remaining years by leaving behind some rich and amazing gifts. Both are inaccurate and fail to do justice to the deep conflict involved in not being honest with myself and others for so long. Acknowledging I am a gay man is freeing, but it also hurts many of those whom I love very much." So,
God damn it.
This is the last quote from here. Yeah, that's it. That's basically, I won't keep reading. It's just really fucking sad. You know, he's 64 years old. He's been lying to himself the entire time.
And that's 93 in gay years. So,
he's a yestergay.
No, yeah.
You know, I'm kind of two minds of that. Like, I want to be as completely generous as I can possibly muster here and say, you know, living some truth in your life is better than living none, for, you know, but so welcome, Ed, and I'm glad you finally have the courage or wherewithal to do this. But at the same time, dude, you were part of a fucking hate group that focused, you know, so much derision and money on fighting against your brothers and sisters in the, you know, under the rainbow. Mm-hmm. And you paid, you know, you had a large income and you paid a lot of tithing towards that fight. So part of me is like, dude, go fuck yourself. Right. But the other part is he is a victim of this traumatizing ideology.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he's the victim of gaslighting. It is an organization.
Self-hatred, shame, just the whole shebang.
Yeah.
Well, let's see. Truly, is there any part of this sad story that was made better by religion? Let's take an inventory. Right. No. Mitchell was clearly a mentally unwell, deranged man. So yeah. add to that the belief that God was talking to him and that women are in fact property. That fucking 14-year-old women is kind of acceptable behavior in this religion.
Children is the word.
Exactly. He may have been stopped much earlier were it not for religious leaders unwilling to confront abuse. Yeah. Barzee was clearly a cruel and abusive person, further deranged by her religious zealotry.
Yeah.
You know, no one can know the terror that Elizabeth felt during her captivity, but by her own admission, she did not flee, in part because now she wasn't a virgin. And her captivity could have been shortened were it not for the fact that in our fucked up religious society, seeing women forced to cover their faces and forbidden from speaking is just something you see on the street and not a cause to call the police.
Yeah, well, it is a cause to call the police, and then the police are fine.
And they don't do anything about it.
Like, yeah. That's a moment where the police officer needed to say, women, I, whatever your religious belief is, I need you to now tell me that
I'm sorry.
Okay.
I don't give a flying fuck about your stupid-ass religion.
Yeah.
You know, I need to see who this person is not a kidnap victim.
Yeah, you need to show me your face, and you need to tell me that you're okay.
Yeah. So there you go. Real happy story made all the better by religion.
Well, and also a nice old guy who never got to be who he really was. Until now.
Yeah, and understanding that this is not an isolated case. Yeah. This is happening through the entirety of the religious world.
Yep.
Yeah, well, I think that's the point you made at the end, Doug, that there is nothing about this story that religion made better.
Right.
And in fact, this story probably, I've always said this about the Elizabeth Smart thing, I think this could only happen in Utah in a weird way, right?
Right.
Because where else is a girl... He called her through the window. He didn't go in the window and get her, right? He called her to come to him. And only in Utah, I think, would because of the patriarchal bullshit, would a girl be inclined to do that. I think any place else, they would scream.
Well, I want to be careful here. By her version of the story is that he came in through the window and woke her up in bed. That's her version.
I'm wrong.
Yeah, well, I just want to be careful.
She was there.
Nevertheless, she had ample opportunities
exactly.
to scream out. And she had been taught, she had also been, I mean, yes, the virgin thing, but she had also been taught plenty that it's not a woman's place to speak out
exactly.
against a man. That, you know, she had been taken down all of the pegs that religion takes women down.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I don't want to say that, Mark, your point about the patriarchal nature of the state 100% played into her state of mind.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sure. Yeah,
sure.
All right. Well, good for religion, I guess. Mm. And
welcome to the dark side, Ed. Just wish you'd done it. Wish you'd done it a long time ago.
Yeah.
All right. Let's move on.